Welcome to the DC Life Uncensored, presented by the Fight Shop New Mecxico, International Strategic Partners, and Damage Control Mouthguards. I'm your host, Micah Frankel of CageMinds.com, and this week we got a big show coming up for you guys, including guests Landon, Vannata of UFC 206, LaMarcus Tucker of RFA 46, and Bellator Kickboxing's Kevin Ross. But we're going to start off backwards with today's show. We normally end it with the CageMinds.com local scene, but that's how we're going to kick it off. This weekend, I was out at the Camel Rock Casino for Legacy Boxing's New Mecxico Top Contenders. The night started off with Isidro Castillo putting a pulverizing beating on Justin Flores, who did not answer the bell after the first round. In the second fight, Christian Castillo catches Angel Avila with a big, dirty right hook that takes down Avila. The first knockdown, Avila is not allowed to continue afterwards. So a huge win for Castillo of Pettis Boxing in his pro debut. Josh Sanchez, Jose Luis Sanchez, some people know him by either name, took out Tavares Teague, who would not answer the bell after the fifth round. Teague gave Sanchez some problems in the early goings of the fight with funky movement and weird level changes. Yes, we're talking boxing, though. It was Sanchez capitalizing, learning, progressing, and evolving, dealing with the style, hitting his opponent when the openings were allowing them in his weird level changes. Sanchez having to change the trajectory of his hook, but still, the guy is able to deal with the situation, able to address, identify it, deal with it, and take out his opponents. He showed that time and time again. Jose Luis Sanchez, another masterful performance, putting it together, showing evolution as a young boxer, heavy hooks, working the body, consistently changing levels, able to identify what you're doing. Another great performance for that young man. Jose Osorio wanted a knockout, was promising us a knockout when we talked to him for the podcast for the special edition. John Herrera, a guy that we normally know as a really defensive fighter, actually traded, swung, put more shots out there than I think I've ever seen. He was able to hit Osorio with some big ones. Also got hit with some big ones. Osorio got overzealous looking for the knockout. Was really, grabbing at the mat to plant his feet. And was just telegraphing it to the whole crowd that he was looking for the knockout, the big shot. Didn't end up paying for it. But when you're seeking the knockout, it does not develop. Osorio will learn from it. But he definitely, with the volume, put it on Herrera for all six rounds. Another win, keeping the win streak going for Jose Osorio. Talking about power, though, someone that was able to find it, generate it, and display it. We normally don't see it out of Jesus Xavier Pacheco. He is a decision fighter. He's been a guy that'll get inside, but he was craving the knockout. He really wanted it, and he found the way to get it. He takes out Gene Pettis. Early on, a lot of us thought this would be the fight of the night. It didn't live up to those standards because of the amazing power punching of Pacheco. Pettis had went the distance with several very highly touted prospects around and is known as a tough guy. To see him go down with the big shots that were landed again from Pacheco with the right hook, the right straight, and closing the night with the left hook, it was a huge display of power and a really shocking, awesome one. I'd have to call that. It was the early candidate for knockout of the night, but we'll tell you about that. Next fight you had was returning from 3 years of inactivity, being on the sidelines. Joaquin Zamora taking on Larry Slow Motion Smith, the late replacement. Smith, awkward style, looping punches, caught Zamora a couple times. Zamora, really stiff, really stagnant. It took him some rounds to get acclimated again, a long time off. But by the third, fourth round, definitely in that sixth round, you could see Zamora totally loose, totally confident, hands down, feints coming, and footwork just hitting, circling. Smith didn't know where it was coming from. A huge win for Zamora, dominating all six rounds. Even though there were some big shots landed from Smith and some tentative moments, it was more about Zamora, the more he found his range, and him using straight punches versus the looping ones that gave him the decision win in a huge comeback. The co-main event of the night, Jason Sanchez taking on the only guy that was brave enough to sign on the dotted line. Sanchez, and I don't know, I guess is a very daunting undefeated prospect for most guys. Sergio Nájera willing to step up, ate the jabs, kept coming, and then succumbed to what a lot of fighters have. The body shot from Sanchez is what puts down Nájera, who does not answer the count. There was a liver punch, six more punches, and a flurry after that, but it was really the liver punch that set it up. Jason Sanchez, his brother Jose Luis Sanchez, you have Angelo Leo, Brian Mendoza, Matthew Griego, and quite possibly Brandon Holmes, a talented pack of prospects with more than six wins, undefeated right now from Albuquerque, New Mexico, and the surrounding area. A lot of excitement with the local boxing and what could be for the future of New Mexico. Now talking about another talented undefeated prospect from Las Cruces. He was in the main event. Agustin Benegas taking on Espanola's own The Warrior, Tony Valdez. Due to Valdez's former connection with Holmes Boxing, who was in the corner of Benegas, the fight became emotionally lit, a combustible situation with vulgarity from the crowd, a lot of yelling, a very emotional scene. This one almost looked like it was going to come down to being more of a brawl. Outside of the drama, the first round, Valdez was able to get his respect, hitting Benegas with a big left hook. Benegas then, halfway through the round, was able to start taking over the ring generalship, putting the pressure on Valdez, was able to start stalking him in the second round, and in the third round, getting Valdez against the ropes, found a left hook to the body. Valdez is the Warrior. Even with that left hook, that would have dropped, I think, most fighters, and several follow-up punches, Valdez was able to clinch, survive. For that moment, he got chased down again, ends up getting knocked down in a slip of where Benegas was charging forward before getting cornered again, succumbing to a flurry of hooks, and eventually nearly hitting the ground, being saved by the ref. The huge TKO win for Benegas, 2:30 of the third round, 10-0, a now jumping up, I mean jumping up in that prospects list. Very underrated. Agustin Benegas, a huge win. You cannot take away from it. Even though there was an emotional scene, a lot of side story, Benegas with the huge win. That prospect, he was on fire. A great night for him. Benegas, definitely the fighter of the night. Even though there were other great performances, as we said, from Jesus Xavier Pacheco and from Jason Sanchez. Now, as far as the fight of the night goes, a lot of these were pretty lopsided in the scorecards or ended ultra quickly. So I think we'd have to go with Joaquin Zamora versus Larry Smith, even though it was a dominant performance. It's still the fight of the night as the most interesting back and forth of what we saw, with Smith awkwardly landing some big looping shots that did give the crowd some tenuous moments. Now, for this episode of the DC Life Uncensored, we had also planned to have another guest on Saturday night. At Buffalo Thunder Resort and Casino, there was the Jackson's MMA Series 20. Now, we had a correspondent team out on the scene. Go on Facebook, Gomez Photo Work, Sal Gomez, amazing art, great stuff up from the fight. Our on-the-scene correspondent writing up the results was Gabby Romero. We had hoped it was going to be possible to have her on this episode. Unfortunately, that was not able to come through. We do got the results, and we can tell you, K-Kai was able to get a first-round TKO with the ground and pound of Thomas Horton. Brian Linares ekes out a split decision over Ambrose Vigil. Chris Rojas, I heard he dominated. Timely takedowns, getting on top of Mark Matthew McGill, getting the ground and pound and winning 30-27 across all three scorecards. Andrea Amaro, 4-0, now 5-0. Tegan Ring, unsuccessful in her freshman amateur MMA experience, losing to a fighter that had quite a bit of experience. Again, go check out the photos, and if we can get with Gabby this week, we will post up a special edition little post, a segment, getting Gabby to give us the play-by-play and her insight on the action that took place. We had Brandon Trujillo taking out Adam Ramirez. Brandon, congratulations on your pro debut win, the first round TKO, putting your strike into good use. Cody Yan takes a unanimous decision from Brandon Jones. Welcome back to the cage and to the win column, Angelo Sanchez taking the unanimous decision dominantly from Josh Wick. And Josh Moreno hands Sonny Yan his first loss. Moreno survived some big takedowns, was able to land an uppercut in the second that hurt Yan. Yan into a bad takedown attempt, guillotine. Moreno, the victory, 2-0, two stoppages. His first time at 185 pounds. I promise we will catch up with him eventually to see how he felt fight night the first time down at that weight class. And again, be looking out for the segment, the review of the Jackson's MMA Series 20. Hopefully we'll get that out to you guys this week. When the DC Life Uncensored continues, I think we're going to talk about some more results, but we're going to talk about the national scene. ISP. That's International Strategic Partners. When you think protection in New Mexico, you should think ISP, not your everyday security company. Offering background checks, self-defense courses, handgun, firearm, licensing, and a plethora of security patrol and investigation options. Call us at 505-255-6063. That's 505-255-6063. 6063 or online at callisp.com.
The Fight Shop New Mexico in the Montaño Plaza Shopping Center, located off Coors and Montaño.
You're back with the DC Life Uncensored, and like I said, it was a busy weekend nationally and locally. We're going to do our national results now, brought to you by Damage Control Mouthguards, the best mouthguards on the planet. Titan closed out 2017 with Titan FC 42, expected to have four title fights. Things do not go as planned, only two title fights. The Bantamweight Championship for Titan FC is no longer vacant. Frank Hartsharapova takes that title with a unanimous decision win over Andrew Whitney, dominating the striking, the wrestling, taking it on one judge's scorecard, four rounds to one. Two more guys did it 3-2. I thought it was more in the 4-1 range. Jason Jackson, one punch, puts down Diego Lima. A controversial stoppage. I think Lima was starting to get back up. But a new Titan FC welterweight champion, Black Zillions member Jason Jackson. Again, a heavy-handed individual. The co-main event was expected to see Jose Torres, Shorty, versus Pedro Nobre for the vacant flyweight title. Nobre, I don't completely know what happened, but he withdrew from the fight. Torres has been given the flyweight title, and we will see him in action in the beginning of the year in January, defending his title at Titan FC 43. So that was on Fight Pass, not to mention you saw some big show vets, Desmond Green, Jay-Z Cavalcante, and Kurt Holaba all get in the win column. So that was on UFC Fight Pass. On Access TV Friday night, you had the final legacy event. We had talked to Josh Lanier in lead up to the event, got hit with a punch, goes down to the ground, got hit with some illegal shots, got overwhelmed, loses to Jesse Hernandez. I don't know if Josh plans to appeal. I believe for him it was a victory to get back in that cage to compete. It was what it was. He did lose. Hernandez, 305 pounds. That is a big boy. Levi Mouse TKO in the second round of Jimmy Flick, at ground and pounding out the wrestler. I mean, Levi Mouse putting together the striking, a very elusive fighter, heck of a pace, relentless, a young bantamweight to bantamweight slash flyweight to keep an eye on for. Belial Williams, as he does, he puts together his punches. He's won 5 of 6. I believe this makes it 6 of 7. Getting Trey Houston out in 2 minutes. Working off of the jab. Finding that right hand. A big TKO. Belial, a big future ahead for him in LFA and possibly leading to the UFC. I think he's still a few fights possibly away. And in the main event, slam, bam, wham. The Legacy Fighting Championship era is ended with Gerald Harris slamming Aaron Cobb, who had jumped guard around Harris from a clinch position, and Harris slamming down Aaron Cobb. A fight that was originally at 170 pounds, and that's what we have at CagedMinds.com. I need to correct that. That was actually a heavyweight fight, as Aaron Cobb missed weight by some 25, 35, 45 pounds, an astronomical number, and a beating deserved of someone who disrespected the sport so badly, said that due to a back problem, he was unable to do the weight cut. Well, it's probably you should have, you know, pulled out of the fight instead of showing up a whole human heavier than you should have been. Quite possibly sat in the sauna, really ate clean, maybe sacrificed in that area, depending on how much you couldn't move if you were really determined to keep the fight. And really now we move on to what would be the biggest event of Friday night's competition, and the second biggest fight of the weekend, headlining this card, Bellator 166. Start off that main card, Chris Honeycutt beating up, taking down, and really handling Ben Ryder disappointingly. Yes, I know. Marcus Goval, big boost of confidence for him getting back in the win column after losing the title. Timely takedowns and control. Still ugly striking, but he pulls out the victory against LC Davis. AJ McKee had to rely on his wrestling, but he's able to pull out the win on the unorthodox striking. Ray Wood, Eduardo Dantas working behind the jab, stuffing the takedowns, beating up the face of Joe Warren. Joe Warren is one ref, inexplicably scores this fight 44-44, a draw. Take away that person's license, get him away from the fight game. Joe Warren had no offense, did nothing to endanger Eduardo Dantas. Eduardo Dantas jabbed, followed it up with his right hand several times. Didn't really get the big knockdowns, but punished the front leg, that left leg of Joe Warren, just destroying it. A clinic of striking put on by the two-time and now and still Bellator bantamweight champion of their world, Eduardo Dantas from Nova Uniao. That was all what we had on Friday night. Now Saturday, you may be thinking, well, where is next for Eduardo Dantas? Well, if you're wondering that, he found out pretty quickly on Saturday night. First off, on the prelims, big shout out to Jonathan Gary getting the unanimous decision win over Aaron Robertson. Spent his camp down here in Albuquerque at the Jackson Wing Camp, so big congratulations to him. The main card started off with Andre Filho running right into a Chidi Njikunwani jab. Couple extra ground and pound punches, but it was all started by that short left jab that he ran into. Njikunwani missed weight by 4 pounds. Bad on him, but big power, heck of a finish. In the women's flyweight division, Alimaleh McFarland was able to out-grapple Emily Doucette, get the top position in the scrambles, avoid some damage, takes the unanimous decision, 29-28 from two judges, 30-27 on another one. That women's flyweight division, it's young, it's building up in Bellator. Some exciting fights. Alimaleh McFarland, another good win. In the co-main event, John Teixeira, normally known for his Brazilian jiu-jitsu. Some people were going to question his striking going into a fight with Justin Lawrence, who we've seen is a very flashy karate and kickboxing striker. It was Teixeira with the Muay Thai, big vicious hooks, and then leg kicks, leg kicks, leg kicks. I believe on the telecast, they said something about it looked like a shark bite, a round ball Justin Lawrence got picked apart. Even when Lawrence did land, Teixeira ate him like none of the shots had any power. Like this lifelong striker who's a knockout artist inside the cage had nothing for him. A dominant showing from John Teixeira, who in his last fight snuck a split decision that a lot of people didn't believe he deserved. This time he announces his dominance, definitely earned this one, and with a steep Bellator featherweight division 2017, it's interesting to see where Teixeira will fall in. Does he get a main event in his next fight? How close is he to a title opportunity? Talking about title opportunities, it's the second meeting, the main event, Bellator 167, Darian Caldwell and Joe Taiminglo. The first fight saw two rounds of domination from Caldwell with his wrestling before he shot into a guillotine in the third round and Baby Joe tapped him out. This fight, Baby Joe was not able to find that submission, even though he had a guillotine, had an armbar attempt. He tried. It was Darian Caldwell floating around submissions, using his wrestling and form of jiu-jitsu to just control and dominate the majority of the fight, take every round, a unanimous decision win. And then you had the face-off, Dantes Caldwell. Dantes called it, "You're just another wrestler who's going to try to take me down, and I've learned how to stop that." Interesting fight, a Bellator bantamweight title fight that you can definitely get excited about. I felt from the first time they met, Dantes may not have been experienced enough to handle the Warren takedowns. That's what came true. I didn't know if Warren had what it took to deal with Galvao, as he couldn't the first time. We saw from the knee bar, he couldn't. And then we went back to Galvao Dantes, and we knew how that was going to go. Because, again, the cleaner, more technical striker, when your ground game is equaled out and you're not forcing an unnecessary ground exchange, Dantes was able to pick him apart. Now, Dantes comes around full circle to Warren, and this is the important fight. Could he break the circle between the three of them? He does it with the majority decision win. I would have called the unanimous because it was so dominant, but one judge doesn't know what they're talking about, how he picked apart Warren. So he's used to dealing with that wrestling. Now he has the wrestling, the younger, the flashier. We've seen the throws, we've seen the submissions. Darian the Wolf Caldwell is the new Bellator number one contender for Eduardo Dantes in that bantamweight title. And that is a Bellator title fight that I can definitely get excited about. That also you had on Saturday night. One other little event going on. Oh yeah, the end of the Ultimate Fighters Tournament of Champions. Tim Elliott, the best flyweight now of the regional and developmental scene, winning the tournament with a pair of submissions and a unanimous decision, and that earns you this opportunity with Mighty Mouse. Some big takeaways from the card. Congratulations to Devin Clark, a unanimous decision win over Josh Stansberry. Anthony Smith taking out Elvis Mutafchich. Rob Font landing a great crane kick and then a well-timed knee. Some punches that took out Matt Schnell. Schnell went off a weight class. You could see the difference in size even from 35 to 25. Schnell needs to be back at flyweight. Big win for Font, getting a stoppage, getting back in the win column. Ryan Hall frustrates the hell out of Gray Maynard with a flashy kicking game and a weird 50-50 guard. If you know Ryan Hall, you know what I'm talking about. If you don't, it's a guy dropping to his back, looking for leg locks consistently, rolling, not wanting to exchange, throwing a lot of kicks. But if you get him punching range, he's falling down immediately for the ground game. A interesting fight, a card guy to game plan for with a strange style. You might have to go down to his world where you're in danger to really land something. Interesting to see who is willing to accept that test next. In the flyweight division, Brandon Moreno, he is a Mexico State Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu champion. And after the win over Luis Smoka, people wondered, is he for real? Well, he was able to keep it going, eating some big shots, showing off a chin, but consistently putting pressure and winning grappling exchanges in taking a split decision win from Ryan Benoit. An ultra-close fight that neither man should really hang their heads in disappointment. It was a war. We also had Sarah McMahon, after taking down Alexis Davis and getting elbowed like crazy While being on top in the first round, we had McMahon take down Davis in the second round and catch an arm triangle. The first round, Sarah McMahon came out like a heavy-handed boxer. It was crazy. But then she got hurt in the grappling exchange and wanted to stay grappling because she was unaware how her face is damaged. Hopefully she's okay. Big win, though, for Sarah McMahon getting a stoppage. Jaren Cannonier put on a show. Light on his feet. Great footwork. Heavy punches. Great dexterity in his kicks. Taking a unanimous decision from Ian Kuntilaba. Kuntilaba was able to get the fight to the ground in the first round and control the exchanges. After that, it was the striking of Cannonier, even showing off his own wrestling game, which we didn't know he possessed. Taking down the longtime Greco-Roman wrestler, I believe, growing up for the Republic of Moldova. Ian Kuntilaba. Jared Cannonier, a well-needed spark in the light heavyweight division. 205 just really needs more guys, and I'm a huge proponent of getting as many dudes in that division as we can. And Jared Cannonier coming down from heavyweight, now 2-0 in the UFC. Great to see that. We also had the craziness of Jake Ellenberger getting his foot stuck in the cage and ended up being TKO'd by Jorge Masvidal. Masvidal was lighting him up on the feet, had exchanged him, and you could see at the end of the fight from the face test, you can understand it was a TKO. An awkward situation, his foot had got stuck in the cage, something that you've never seen before, but his toe, I don't know if it's broken. Jorge Masvidal took advantage of the situation, got the win, looked like he was on his way to getting the win, unless Ellenberger could change something. Masvidal was in control of that fight, a big win. The co-main event, ever so close, 1 point taken away from Henry Cejudo for low blows to Joseph Benavidez. Benavidez landed, I believe, the more volume, had the statistics in his favor. Cejudo, the heavier shots. I could go 29-28, which ends up being 29-27. With the 1 point deduction, a very close fight, a lot of strikes thrown, a lot of action packedness in 15 minutes. Very entertaining between Benavidez and Cejudo. I don't know if either man with this performance is again ready for a title fight, but it was an interesting fight. They're both very tough. It was close. Hopefully their little beef is squashed. But I did have Benavidez the winner, and he does pull it out. Even though he ate some big counter punches, he was able to land a volume of punches on Cejudo. Leading us up to the main event that saw Demetrius Johnson be aware of the length, the size of Tim Elliott, who is one of the bigger who is flyweights in the division, who did have a hard time making weight. Johnson didn't like what he was seeing on the feet, tried to take it to the ground, dove into a couple unnecessary guillotines, and almost got submitted, it looked like, guillotine to a Darius choke. Tim Elliott, shock everybody, most scorecards would have him winning that first round. From then on out, the next four rounds saw Mighty Mouse taking the fight to the ground and being able to switch from side control to the back, to Elliott escaping the back, getting back to side control, a lot of top position, floating over. DJ went for the Kimura several times, a rear naked choke, arm bar, was never able to find the submission before rounds of control, not anything fight ending, not anything damaging, not anything vicious or violent, but very technical, very strategic, and a almost George Rush St. Pierre-esque top game performance from Demetrius Johnson in victory and in tying George Rush St. Pierre on the UFC list of most consecutive title defenses. Now at 9, his next one would be 10 if he's able to get it, tying Anderson Silva. 11 would get him the record for most title defenses as a UFC champion, and that is a record that means a lot to Mighty Mouse. Mighty Mouse is looking for that record. It'll be interesting to see who is the next challenger to his throne, as that division, I think, is still looking for a spark, for a guy to really grab the bull by the horns. We were able to get by and get this title defense put together with this Ultimate Fighter season and Tim Elliott. But has anybody been lighting the world on fire? I mean, in theory, there was hope that a Louis Smoka could pick up the torch and run with it after he got the win over Paddy Houlihan in Ireland on short notice in a main event. But Brandon Moreno shuts that down. Brandon Moreno again takes this victory, but right now that only puts him at the top 12. So we're looking for a name in that 125-pound division to really grab people's attention to earn a big title fight. It could be Koji Hadoguchi, who just came off of a win over Aliyev Bagalatinov, but I think even Koji in his camp would probably like one more fight. Maybe you get a Joseph Benavidez to prove to yourself if you're mentally ready for that challenge of Mighty Bouts, because Benavidez would retain that number one contender spot. Even though in the rankings he's the number one contender, he's not really, with two losses to Mighty Mouse, in line to ever get that title shot again. That'd be craziness to go 0-2 and get a third title shot. I don't think that Frankie Edgar could drop down that low, because they love to give Frankie title shots in the UFC. Oh, that was a couple years ago. But interesting to see who will be the next challenger for Demetrius Johnson. I guess Koji Hadoguchi, as I'm thinking about it, would be the main name I would throw in that hat. But I think he'd even probably like a fight with Benavidez just to prove to himself that he's totally ready for that. So we've talked about the local scene, we've talked about the national scene, and the weekend that was. We're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we're going to get to some interviews, and then we still got a preview the weekend that's upcoming. There is a lot in store for you as the DC Life Uncensored continues.
We're a dental laboratory that specializes in protective mouth guards for all sports. With the input and collaboration of professional athletes, dentists, and chemical engineers, Damage Control offers protection that is up to 417% greater than the competition. And a great fit that will make you forget you're even wearing a mouth guard. UFC champions, professional bull riding champions, and Mr. Olympian champions. These are athletes that depend on us for the ultimate protection. It's the most comfortable, most protective, and best fitting mouth guard. Breathe better, feel better, play better with a Damage Control mouth guard.
The Fight Shop New Mexico in the Montaño Plaza Shopping Center, located off Coors and Montaño.
Welcome back to the DC Life Uncensored. Right now, we're going to welcome in UFC lightweight Groovy Landon Vannata. Thank you for the time, sir. How you doing?
I'm doing all right, man. Doing okay.
The short notice call-up, you make it to the UFC. What was that like right away, just getting the call and finally knowing that you're going to get to the UFC? What was that moment?
Oh, you know, man, that was just, it's exciting. Definitely exciting. It's just, knew it was going to come eventually, and finally came, and just couldn't be happier about it.
And what was the first initial thought about Tony Ferguson?
Tough fight. Especially on 2 weeks' notice. But, confident I had the skills to go get it done.
There was a lot of people out there picking an upset, thinking that Ferguson could overlook you, not knowing anything about you, and being a bad stylistic matchup. So after the first round, what were your feelings going into that corner? You had landed some big shots. You were doing really well.
Yeah, no, I was completely exhausted into the first round. Coming out 2 weeks' notice, having shit for a gas tank, and going at that high of a pace for 5 minutes, completely blew my lock and just had nothing left in me. So there was no thought going into the corner. It was just trying to catch my breath, trying to get my body to keep working.
You end up being exhausted, getting caught up in a choke from a really long-term opponent. So what did you do going back to the gym? What were your thoughts besides need more cardio, I guess, all the time if you're going to take a fight on two weeks' notice? What were your thoughts on moving forward?
Nah, man, it's just, I'm not even upset about how it played out, you know. Gave me a chance to shock the world, which is my intention going into that fight. Definitely shocked the world, definitely got my name out there. And going forward, just I'm doing the same things I've always been doing. I got a full camp under me this time, full 8 weeks of training, and I'm just ready for whatever lies ahead.
Now, the suit in the post-fight, was that strategically planned after you shocked the world you were going to look pimp as fuck?
Yeah, man. Yeah, I went about that a few beforehand. I mean, I went about it a few days beforehand, so it wasn't tailored or anything. It didn't fit perfect, but yeah, I want to rock that suit for this next fight, too.
Something about the color scheme, what do you like in there?
I like the way it looks, like the way it feels.
Nice. Now, also, we saw recently UFC Ultimate Insider. They did a showcase on you. So, is it good that to see and know that everyone around has acknowledged that performance and what you did on 2 weeks against Ferguson?
Yeah, man, it's awesome to finally have my name being mentioned up there where I've always thought it belonged. I always knew it belonged. And it's going to keep going up and up and up in here. But yeah, it's cool. It's cool to be talked about the way I should be talked about.
Now, heading into the fight with McDessie, what do you think about him? And I'm pretty sure this is someone that you've emulated before for people in training camps, right?
No, I never emulated McDessie before. But, yeah, man, I think he's, you know, he's obviously an experienced vet. He's got a lot of ring time under his belt. He knows what he's doing in there. A basic karate fighter. Predictable in his movements and his actions. Good striker. But I think he's... I think it's a good stylistic matchup for myself, and it shouldn't be a huge challenge to take him out.
Again, predictable. We know what he does good. We know what he does well. We know that he likes to move forward. So, is that just line up for you great with your flowing kind of style and your unpredictableness?
Yeah, man. I think... you know, and not just my style, but, you know, having my coach in my corner, guys like Greg and game planning with me, and just really picking apart his style. Greg knows McDessie pretty well. He's been down here and trained a couple times before back in the day, and, you know, we know what he does. We know what his habits are, and we're going to expose him.
We know you're a gym rat in there all the time, but is there a different feeling for this camp with a fight on this level now being your first full camp for a UFC fight?
Is there a different feeling? Nah, man, it's the same thing. I mean, I've always said every fight feels the same to me. The UFC, my first UFC fight, my first professional fight, my fight in Japan, this fight, they all feel the same. All the training feels the same. So, there's no additional nerves, nothing different about the training, nothing different about the feel of the whole camp. Everything just feels as it always does.
What are some goals that you have as a martial artist, immediate ones to for your progression?
Nothing really. Don't really have too many goals, man. Just enjoying following the passion and enjoying the process of it all. There's no real end goal in mind. There's no things that I'm really, like, that's what I need to do. No, I like training. I like fighting. I like making money. And those are the three things I'm setting out to do.
So we know there were some perks coming off of the performance, a bonus, and you got to go take a nice little vacation, did a bunch of traveling. What was that like for you, getting that experience, getting some time away, and being out of the gym for a while again, and getting out and traveling?
Yeah, that was much needed, man. That was my first, time I got to take off more than a few days in the past 5 years. So that was very much needed, and it was, you know, something that I loved. It was great. Hitting up a bunch of different national parks, meet a bunch of old friends, and just enjoying my time on the road. It's a lot of fun. And I'm going to go do a little more traveling after this fight as well.
Having reached this pinnacle, getting to the UFC, it's one of those benefits right now. Coming off a fight, you're able to do that, to take a vacation instead of have to straight look for another fight.
Yeah, exactly. It's nice to be able to... I always like to give my body a break even before I got in the UFC. I tried to take a few weeks off right after my fight. You know, I used to do that, and I would have to stay in Albuquerque while I did that. Now I'm able to go out and go abroad and see what's going on in the world a little bit. Expand my horizons a little bit more. That's a lot of fun.
A fighter union. Do you have any thoughts on that kind of thing, if it's needed or not, either way? For MMA fighters?
To be honest, I really don't pay attention to that side of the sport, man, so I don't know a whole lot about it. But yeah, I mean, I'm just here for the ride, so see what happens with it. Could be good, might not be, I don't know. I have no idea.
Well, that's a different outtake on it.
I don't really know much about giving consent, so I would sound like a fool if I tried to say anything.
At least you're honest.
Yeah.
I'm like, that's the best thing. At least he's honest right there. We know that things will be changing. But somebody's like, just kind of here to fight and train. And that's where I thought some guys may be at the point. There's some dudes that are veteran enough where this is so much of a business to them. And then there's probably still guys that are coming up that this is the journey and you're enjoying it as it goes. And you're not that, into the financial side of it yet.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely like the financial side, but I don't know much about the whole body and everything to really make a comment on it, so I just stay in my own lane for now.
Well, going up to Canada, and I believe this is not going to be your first time fighting up there, right?
No, it's my first time in Canada. I've been to Mexico, Japan, and Minnesota. First time in Canada for fights.
First time up in Canada. Now, on that aspect, we know you like the traveling. Is there anywhere else that you're really hoping with the UFC? We know they have the global outreach of a place for you that you'd want to fight.
You know, with the whole tax thing, being having to get taxed abroad and back at home, I would like to just fight in the U.S. as much as possible so I can save my money for traveling to the places I actually want to travel to on my own dime.
I believe, isn't it states like Texas and I believe Florida have no state tax?
Yeah, I don't know which states, but there are some that have no state tax, so, yeah, I'll fight there. That'd be great.
So we don't know too much about the other side of the financials. We do know where the taxes are so that you can use the money for the fun stuff.
Exactly, yeah.
Now that's interesting. I actually didn't know that you got taxed abroad and then back home. That does put a different spin on international travel.
Yeah, I believe. I mean, it's my first time. Pretty much fighting abroad. Not first time fighting abroad, but making a decent amount of money. So I believe that what I make abroad, I can write off on my U.S. taxes. I'm not 100% sure on that, but yeah, something like that. So it's not that bad, but still going to be losing a little bit of money by fighting in another country.
Well, then between fighting in all these other countries, Colorado, here, Minnesota, where is it on your list to get back to fight around your home area where you were born and raised?
Yeah, I would love to fight down in Tampa. That'd be awesome. I have my parents there, my friends, my whole family. That'd be great to fight down in Tampa.
Also, looking at the lightweight division right now, who do you look at and see as the other top guys in the division, the guys that you think are going to be up there in the upper echelon when you're making your run at the title shot, too?
Yeah, man, like, so future prospects in that division, definitely guy like Gregor Gillespie. He's come down here and trained before. He's very, very, very good. That's another dude that would be up at the top of the ranks very soon. That's probably the only guy I know. That's just because I've trained with him. I don't really pay too much attention to who's in the division. So I'm not exactly sure.
And right now inside of the UFC, of the guys that are up there at the upper echelon, who do you think is the toughest guy? McGregor has the belt. You fought Ferguson. Nurmagomedov also has the giant win streak. Who do you look at and think is the best guy in the division? I know there's a champion, but he's really only fought in the division once.
You know, I think all three of those dudes, Tony, Khabib, and Conor, could beat each other on any given night. I could see Conor knocking out Khabib. I could see Khabib grinding out Conor. I could see Tony beating both of them as well, and vice versa. But I think those are the three dudes currently in the division who are at the top of the game.
You don't watch the division too much, but did you watch the Ferguson versus Dos Anjos fight?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, definitely watching that one.
So did you get the same feeling that I did? Wow, Landon did a lot better against Tony Style than RDA did. RDA looked pretty bad in that fight. Did you get any other confidence from that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, shows how much power I have. Being able to put Tony down a few times, and RDA was unable to, even with a few clean shots. My movement was much more effective against Tony than RDA's was. And yeah, I mean, it really upped my stock that night. It was good. It's a great showing for Tony and myself.
And now we know you like the outdoors and everything. It's starting to get cold out here in Albuquerque. Got any things that you want to get done for the winter outside of fighting?
No, traveling and probably get some snowboarding in this winter. It's been a few years.
It's been a few years?
Up the tiles.
Always fun to get up there, and I know it's some great scenery. So you haven't snowboarded in a few years, but you used to do it a lot?
Yeah, when I was younger. But, you know, I've been poor the whole time. I've been living out here, so I haven't had the funds. And this year I do. So I'll be getting out on the slopes a little bit. Getting back to that.
Being able to do this stuff, how rewarding is it finally getting that satisfaction of, is there a level of feeling that you made it when you're able to do these sorts of things, get back to these hobbies, have this free time?
I mean, I don't think that I've made it yet. I've only had one fight. But it's just nice to be able to do the things that I like to do. And a lot of my hobbies are expensive, so it's nice to be able to indulge in those now that I have some funds in my bank account. But still got a long way to go, and it's a lot more fun to have.
Okay, so we got the traveling, we got the snowboarding. What's something else that you can't wait to be able to get back to doing again?
Riding motorcycles.
Of course, these fighters.
Yeah, the other one.
MMA, it's like the cousin of the X Games, I feel like. That's where everybody transitions. It's either one or the other.
Yep. Yeah, well, I did one before the other.
And could you see yourself a day where you go back to maybe doing some racing, doing that again for some fun?
Nah. I mean, I like it as a hobby, but, yeah, I don't know. We'll see where the cards unfold, but, you know, I just like riding. Just having a little fun with my friends.
Have you got to hit out here and go through the sand dunes, get on the ATVs and do that stuff?
Yeah, I've been on some dirt bikes out here, tearing up in the sand dunes out on the west side. Always fun, man. Always fun. Skydiving, too. That's the only thing. Get back to that. Got a few jumps. Gotta go get my license, though.
So is there, like, different heights that you've jumped from?
Solo, I've only jumped from 5,000 few jumps. Gotta work your way up. Do some parachute jumps, and then you go higher to free fall.
Is jumping out of a plane comparable to anything that you do inside of the mixed martial arts world?
Yeah, it's just like stepping in the cage and fighting, man. Just that little bit of an adrenaline rush where you're just so focused and so in the zone. You're in a complete flow state and it's just pure bliss, at least for me.
So we'd label you somewhere in between an outdoorsman and an adrenaline junkie?
Yeah, you know, a slightly eccentric, thrill-seeking, movement-loving vagabond is how I explain myself.
And one of the future faces of the UFC's lightweight division.
Yeah.
Landon Vannata, it's been great talking to you like always. December 10th, UFC 206. I believe you're on the FS1 prelims card?
I believe so too. I'm not 100% sure though, to be honest. And I'm then not sure if I'm on bypass or FS1, but I think FS1.
We'll keep you guys updated on that. And then again, with USADA and injuries, that could change from when we record this interview to when Landon actually gets to fight night. Thank you for the time, sir. To all the listeners, there'll be more DC Life Uncensored in just a moment.
The Fight Shop New Mexico in the Montaño Plaza Shopping Center, located off Coors and Montaño.
ISP. That's International Strategic Partners. When you think protection in New Mexico, you should think ISP, not your everyday security company, offering background checks, self-defense courses, handgun, firearm, licensing, and a plethora of security patrol and investigation options. Call us at 505-255-6063. That's 505-255-6063.
6063 or online at callisp.com.
Welcome back to the DC Life Uncensored. Right now we're going to get to welcome in LaMarcus Tucker, RFA 46, the final RFA event. This man is in the main event fighting for the light heavyweight title. Thank you for the time. How you doing?
Man, I'm doing good, sir. Doing well.
You're going to be the hometown local favorite, not too far away from where you live, the final RFA event, a main event on Access TV. Give us some thoughts on all this, all these big, great things happening to you, and what this means.
Man, this means the world to me, man. I've been grinding real hard for the opportunity. Been putting the work in now for years, man, and it's my time to shine, so I plan on putting on the show.
Some boxing background, some MMA. You've been in combat sports for a while. What is it about MMA that drew you into MMA particularly?
And I started MMA about going on 6 years ago now. Man, I finished playing college ball. I weighed in about 296 pounds, man. My buddy asked me to come down and see if I like it. I went down there. I got beat up by one of the top heavyweights, Justin Frazier. And then ever since then, I said, man, I got to get good enough to beat this guy in the gym. And then I fell in love with it.
MMA or boxing? Do you have more of a love out of either sport?
Oh, man. Like, right now, man, MMA is my love, but I kind of got a passion for the boxing, man. You know what I'm saying? I look at boxing like I'm saying, an advanced chess match. You know what I'm saying? You got to have, be ready for your next move, man. You got to be on it. And MMA, man, you know what I'm saying, it's just like, you know what I'm saying, a quick and aggressive checker game, man. You're trying to get to your king and dominate the board. But as of right now, man, I'm, you know what I'm saying, I'm trying to do something that's never been done before. I'm trying to hold a belt in both sports.
Yeah, we look at it, your boxing career, it's been this year, getting all of your action in, and then one MMA fight. So, was that by design? Was that something you really wanted to test yourself, was in the boxing? And that's what led her. You take fights as they come, this is just what was working out.
Man, with MMA, it just guys were, like, ducking out on me, man. Like, I was set up to have, like, four MMA fights this year, and then some of them didn't go through. I was supposed to fight Jordan this summer down in his hometown, but he signed with RFA, so that didn't go through. And then my boxing coach was like, hey, man, you know, if you ain't going to be doing MMA, let's get you a couple boxing matches. And I said, all right, let's do it. And I'm saying, like, his goal for me is to get at least 5 or 6 boxing matches a year. So,
as far as the MMA realm, getting this shot with RFA, we know that's a shot with LFA. So do you feel that you're going to be able to be more consistent now, hopefully, having signed with a bigger show?
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? That's the plan, man. I hope I can stay more active with MMA. They did. I mean, like, don't have nothing coming up for you. You're more than welcome to go out and pursue your boxing. I really do appreciate that from them.
Lenient. This promotion is willing to work with you and allow you to go after your goal.
Yes. As long as I get my heads up and make sure it's worth my time too, not to get in something that's not going to be worth my time. You know what I'm saying? And I, you know what I'm saying, he was really, really down to earth about it, and I really appreciate it for it.
And either way you look at it right now, you're in a, it's not a weak division, but there's a lack of depth either way for boxing or MMA for you. So does that, having a hard time finding fights, kind of cross over? You're in, you know, the 205. It's a little bit of a weird weight class either way.
Yeah, it's kind of, you know, with the boxing, I have to lose the extra 5 pounds to fight at cruiserweight. But most of my boxing matches, I have to fight heavyweight because, you know what I'm saying, I couldn't get any cruiserweights here in America. But the plan for me is to be fighting over there overseas at cruiserweight, you know what I'm saying, at the 200-pound division. But like I said, with LFA coming up next year, man, I hope I can stay active. Preferably, if they could, I'll fight every month if they'll let me.
wanting to stay busy. Good opportunity to do that. You win this fight. You're the champion. Were you surprised? You know, main event, title fight, all of this with your debut with the promotion?
Man, I was shocked, man. I was feeling very, like, overwhelmed at the moment when they told me, like, hey, man, you're fighting for a title. I'm like, real? You know, and you're going to be the main event. I'm like, oh, man, let's get it. You know, and like I said, man, you know, putting in this work, man, I never thought I was going to get a big opportunity like this. And, you know what I'm saying, I'm just really stoked for the moment, man. I'm ready.
And the first time was going to be in Jordan's hometown, now not too far away from your hometown. Is it excitement or do you feel added pressure with all of this so quickly?
Oh, man, not at all, man. Not at all, man. I'm excited, man, to fight in a Branson, man, right up the street from my people. Then I got people down there in Missouri. So, man, it's gonna be live down there.
And all of this combat sports, this came after your football career, right?
Yes.
So how much of being an athlete and having been in, you know, big situations from that, you know, football career, how has that helped translate over in the mental aspect to the MMA and boxing?
Oh, man, you know, that work ethic that the coaches instill into you, getting up those early mornings, running, lifting, dieting, you know what I'm saying? That really helped the transition for me perfectly. And give me that mindset that in a big situation, you can overcome anything as long as you give your all to it.
Seeing where you're at in MMA, this fight is so big. I mean, you and Jordan are the number one and number two North American top-ranked prospects for the 205-pound division. So, six fights in your career, were you surprised that it's such a big fight that there's such an importance on this one?
Oh, man, like I said, man, it's incredible, man, to even thought of in that light, man, and I'm just, you know what I'm saying, I'm ready for it, man, I'm ready to do this, I hope he's ready.
Have you noticed, you know, just in you trying to get a fight and everything, the lack of depth that there is at 205 pounds?
Man, yeah, man, it sucks, man, that you can't get guys in your weight division. You either got to, you know what I'm saying, go up and fight some of those bigger guys, you know what I'm saying, take on them, or you try to get a guy in your weight class who has a decent record, but then they're afraid to fight you because they don't want to mess their record up. You know what I'm saying? And then you just say, well, I go get this guy who got 9 fights, but I know he's not that good, but it doesn't look good for you as a competitor.
Getting into this one, we've talked about your boxing. Jordan has his wrestling. People will look at this as it's striker versus grappler, but you have a pair of submissions on your record too. So how do you see this fight?
Like I said, I see it as a great matchup for myself because I train with top wrestlers throughout the week with Justin Frazier and with Dave Burrow, with those guys on the ground. So, but standing up, man, that's the game plan going in, and I just think this is a good matchup. I think the fans are really going to love it. And because I think when Jordan see that the takedown ain't going to work for him, he's going to stand and bang with me.
Is there a plan B?
Plan B? Oh, I'll wrestle him.
And you think that'll be a possibility?
What was that?
That you can out-wrestle him, beat him at his own game?
Oh, yeah, man. Like I said, anything is possible in MMA. You know what I'm saying? The better man is going to win that night.
Anything is possible in MMA. You got into the gym. You fell in love with it. Did you see yourself as a fighter right away, or did this take time that you could actually see yourself as competing and doing this for a living?
Oh, man. Like, I did not see it. My coaches, when I first got in there, he told me, he said, hey, man, you're going to be champion one day. And, you know, you just going in thinking that they're just saying that to, you know what I'm saying, get you motivated. But he told me, he kept telling me this every day, Tuck, just keep grinding, keep working, man. You're going to do something with this. You know what I'm saying? And then when I started winning and, you know what I'm saying, I got in the cage and it started clicking.
Does this compare from the football days? Do you still feel that you're living out possibly a childhood dream of attaining being a professional athlete?
Oh, man, this is definitely, man, because, you know, playing football, man, I really had in my mind that I was going to be in the NFL one day, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, but it didn't work out like that, man. But like my grandfather said, he told my mom growing up that I was going to be something special. And come December 9th, man, I'm going to do something special that night. So, man, I'm real excited, man. The dream is coming true.
Does it feel right, even though you probably would have hoped it was football? Does it feel right now, being a fighter, having this journey, going through it?
Yeah, man, it feels good because, like, you know, as playing college ball, you know, you know what I'm saying, you playing for yourself, but you're playing for a team. But for me, it's all on me. It's all, like I'm saying, the work that I put in, it's all on me. The grind, the hustle, it's all on me. And I got to get out and I got to do it. And, man, it's going to be more gratifying doing it this way.
MMA is the team game when you're in the gym and everybody's helping you get prepared. You step in that cage, it's your own. Is it a different experience than anything that you had felt on that field before?
Man, no, not at all, not at all.
What did it mean to you capturing this RFA title, doing it on their last show, Access TV, such a big stage? What would that mean?
Man, that would mean the world to me, man. To do something like that on that big of a stage with my friends, my family, everybody's watching, man. That is going to be the greatest thing ever, next to me being married to my wonderful wife and having my three wonderful children, man. It's going to be up there. Be champion. There's no doubt about it, man. There's no doubt about it. The hard work that I put in, the grind I've been putting in, man, I'm ready to showcase what I have, man. It's going down. Freight train coming.
Bring it up. The nickname, the freight train. Was that something from before, or was that a nickname that you've picked up since MMA?
Oh, man, it's a funny story. So, the announcer, like, before the show, the commission in Arkansas, they saw what my name was. It was Big Bad Mother Tucker, and the commission was like, no, we're not going to call you that. I was like, oh, okay. So I'm in the cage, and then you're the announcer. Oh, my God, he's hitting him like a freight train. He's coming at him like a freight train. And ever since then, it's stuck.
Can I put my vote in that I like Big Bad Mother Trucker better?
I know, I did too, man, but the commission was like, nah, we're not going to call you that. We're not going to call you that.
Oh, that would have been so epic. Okay. I guess I could see how that wouldn't work out for the commission standards, but still so much better on a t-shirt, I believe.
Yes, it did. Yes, yes.
So, on that note, any chance of changing that nickname back at all?
Man, like I said, if I get to make it to the big time, like UFC or Bellator or World Series, I say, hey, man, can I give my Big Bad Mother Tucker name back? And they agree to it, you know, I might go to it, maybe.
Definitely one of the more interesting nickname stories I've got to hear. I will definitely say you have that. It's been great getting to talk to you. Great getting to know you, LaMarcus. Last thing is, who did you need to thank and who did you need to shout out to?
Oh, okay, first of all, man, I want to thank all the fight fans that's going to be attending this fight, who's going to be watching it worldwide. I want to thank my sponsors, RCI Services, Incredible Kid Care, Gillahan Body Shop, White River Country Club, Cyber Vape. Thank those guys, man. I'd like to thank Legendary Supplements. Don't be ordinary, become legendary. I want to thank my parents, man. My mom, she's been riding me about this, and she's probably one of the best people in my life who kept me motivated, because she said, I don't want you fighting because you ain't in the UFC, you ain't known the big times and all that, and now I'm on my way up, you know what I'm saying? And she's like, baby, I gotta eat them words now. So I just want to thank her, man, very much, most especially, and I want to thank, you know what I'm saying, RFA for this opportunity, man. I appreciate it.
LaMarcus Tucker, thank you for the time. Everybody, RFA 46, the last RFA event. It's going to be this Friday, Access TV. You got to tune in, see who walks away with the light heavyweight title. There'll be more DC Life Uncensored after a quick break.
We're a dental laboratory that specializes in protective mouth guards for all sports. With the input and collaboration of professional athletes, dentists, and chemical engineers, Damage Control offers protection that is up to 417% greater than the competition. And a great fit that will make you forget you're even wearing a mouth guard. UFC champions, professional bull riding champions, and Mr. Olympian champions. These are athletes that depend on us for the ultimate protection. It's the most comfortable, most protective, and best fitting mouth guard. Breathe better, feel better, play better with a Damage Control mouth guard.
The Fight Shop New Mexico in the Montaño Plaza Shopping Center, located off Coors and Montaño.
You're back with the DC Life Uncensored, and now that we've covered the weekend that was, and you've heard from UFC 206's Landon Vannata and RFA 46's LaMarcus Tucker, we got to get into previewing the events they will both be a part. And don't forget, also still to come, Bellator Kickboxing's Kevin Ross will be here. But let's start off. We got a huge weekend of fights that we're going to start off with the UFC. The UFC with a quick return to New York, Albany, New York, UFC Fight Night 102, only on UFC Fight Pass. Get right into the main event. Heavyweights in the main event and co-main event. Derek Lewis versus Shamil Abdurakhimov. You got America versus Russia. Lewis, the number 10 ranked light heavyweight contender. Abdurakhimov, the number 15 ranked guy. Lewis is not technical. It's not pretty. He is a beast. Abdurakhimov has the tendency to be too patient, too lacking in his aggression, and I think that could be a real big downfall here against Lewis, who seems to be on a rise, getting stronger. As long as his cardio can keep up with his aggression, he does wonders. You also have some very interesting fights throughout this card, like the co-main event, where you're going to see Francis Ngannou, who has just been dominant with his hands in the heavyweight division and his footwork, taking on Anthony Hamilton. Has the wrestling advantage? Will he be able to put it to use, or will he suffer defeat against the hands of Ngannou? Hamilton, we did see his striking ability. He does have that. He's had a huge head kick before. Put his hands together in his last fight to get a quick TKO win. Corey Anderson versus Sean O'Connell is also on the card, and that fight really sticks out as one that could be a fight of the night. O'Connell always down to bang, always willing to put himself in danger in, you know, hopes of putting on an exciting fight. So also some other ones that could pique your interest if you're a RFA fan. Former RFA welterweight champion Brian Camozzi is going to make his promotional debut against Dana White's looking for a fight found fighter, Randy Brown, Rude Boy, the long, lengthy kid that likes to strike. Camozzi can strike and grapple. Is he able to put Brown moving backwards on the ground, make him feel uncomfortable? Talking about other people that we've found through some, you know, really magnificent ways, or that we've seen development. I mean, this is an RFA battle. Former RFA alums, Joe Gigliotti taking on Gerald Murchard. That one is definitely going to be exciting in the middleweight division. Murchard can get it down standing or on the ground. Gigliotti, big strong cat that likes to use his wrestling. Talking about using his wrestler, Ultimate Fighter winner Andrew Sanchez taking on Trevor Hot Sauce Smith. Smith, ultra durable usually, does not need to be fighting at 205 pounds. Back down at middleweight, let's see what the Ultimate Fighter and RFA alum Andrew Sanchez has to offer. I believe that his grappling, as normally, will be his best method to victory. Also exciting, talking about the tough winners, you do have Tatiana Suarez making her full UFC debut, her first fight off the show since winning the Ultimate Fighter, taking on Juliana Lima from Brazil. Can she win the grappling against the Muay Thai expert? That's what you look for from Suarez. Can she, you know, inflict her grinding style against a well-seasoned, well-rounded fighter who has succumbed to wrestling before? And that is kicking off the card. one more that is going to be very exciting. Frankie Pettis versus Mark DeGazzi. Two fun strikers. This one in the lightweight division, as most 155-pound fights are, is a can't-miss curtain. We continue Friday night looking at Branson, Missouri, which will be host to RFA 46, the final Resurrection Fighting Alliance event. Who can walk away with that light heavyweight title in the final event? Will it be Johnson or will it be Tucker? You know that Johnson, Jordan Johnson, he wants to wrestle. You know that Tucker, LaMarcus Tucker, would like to keep it standing. As we talked about, the boxing experience, the MMA striking ability. We know where each guy wants this fight, and that's what's going to make this one a truly exciting event and a truly exciting main event. I emphasize the desperate need, whether it is Bellator, WSOF, UFC, ONE Championship, 205 pounds, heavyweight divisions. There needs to be more depth all around. There's a lack of big guys. And here are two of the best prospects that you have in America gonna go to war, to battle here in this final RFA event. I mean, RFA going out in style, knowing how to put on a show. Not to mention the co-main event with last week's guest. We talked with Dennis Hill. Can he hand James Nakashima his first professional loss? That will definitely be a fun one to watch. I'm very excited to see Hill after talking to him, after hearing about him. And we've seen Nakashima, the way he has evolved, grown his game, put to work, put to use in the cage, what they have taught him at the lab, and seen it develop inside of that RFA cage. A stat card, the last fight, you have a women's catchweight bout, I believe, on the card. Katie Collins, 5-1, taking on Mandy Polk, 3-2. Almost every time you see a woman's fight on a card, it will steal the show. There was definitely a fun night of fights when you closed out Legacy. RFA, I believe there's still that little promotional rivalry, and I believe seeing how Legacy went out, seeing the cheer, seeing the emotion, seeing the electric scene, that'll only push RFA and the people associated with the promotion to push and make this Friday night such a huge culmination of what they did and celebration leading into what we're going to see with LFA, Legacy Fighting Alliance, in 2017. Big things for the developmental scene of mixed martial arts, getting these guys turned into true proven contenders as they move on to some of these big promotions, even huger promotions, I guess, as these are already big promotions. And that is just what is going down on Friday. Again, UFC Fight Night on Fight Pass and RFA on Access TV. Saturday, again, another crazy day. Bellator is back. Bellator, again, you know, flourishing and trying to grow their business globally. Bellator is back over in Italy, in Florence this time. Not sure how many people know or not, but Rafael Carvalho, the Bellator middleweight champion, will no longer be rematching Melvin Manhoef in the Bellator 186 main event. Carvalho has withdrawn from the fight. So you're now looking at a main event of a light heavyweight bout between UFC vets Alessio Sicara and Joey Beltran. In a perfect world, these two guys are going to stand in the center of the ring, drop bombs, and whoever has more gas by the end will be the victor. In Italy, it's a hard win. With the travel, I believe that Sicara, by decision, will be able to edge out Beltran. But Beltran, down at middleweight, I like him better at 205. He seems to have more cardio, more willingness to trade. He really had such a rock-solid chin at heavyweight. It hasn't transitioned. He's been through so many wars, already 30 fights under his belt. But that will be an exciting brawl for the main event. Felipe Lins and Clover Silva also on the main card. John Salter and Claudio and Canelo. Goichi Yamaguchi returning to the cage very quickly, taking on Valery Mecca. Look for Goichi to use this opportunity to really be able to lift himself. We need more contenders at light heavyweight. And with Felipe Lins and Alessio Sicara both having the upper hands, hopefully someone can make an impression. Middleweight, John Salter looking to prove that he is valid in wanting to be in the middle of the Bellator middleweight title contention. He took out Brandon Halsey, the former champion. He wants his recognition due for that. Now, also taking place in Italy with the same card after this card, you have Bellator kickboxing. We're going to be joined by Kevin Ross, who's going to be in action at that event. You're also going to have Denise Kuhlholz fighting for the women's flyweight title, Georgie Petrosian, possibly the best lightweight kickboxer on the planet, and the always, always, always exciting Joe Schilling will be in action. That is happening the same time, but keep this in mind, it will not be televised on Spike TV till the following weekend. It will precede Bellator 169. Bellator will again be overseas next week in their debut in Ireland, in Dublin. We'll talk more about that next week, but King Mo Satoshi Ishii, following that show being shown on Spike TV, you will then see, preceding that, the Bellator Kickboxing 3 card. So keep that in mind. We talked about it a little bit here. Who you're going to see when. You love that red corner when you're Bellator. Interesting stuff. Again, Kevin Ross, Joe Schilling, Denise Kuhlholz, and Georgie Petrosian. Looking forward to some exciting kickboxing taking place. We'll get the results, but you can then watch it the following weekend. So that's what Bellator has going on. And we're mentioning kickboxing, so we cannot fail to mention that the biggest heavyweight kickboxing fight imaginable is also going down this Saturday in Germany. Glory. Three parts of Glory. Your Super Fight Series, your Glory 36, and your Glory Collision Course. So let's start off how they're going to start off the night. With the Super Fight Series, where you're going to see two women's semifinals. Semifinals from the 122-pound tournament that has been going on. The semifinals will include Isis Verbeek versus Abel Hedby. And the other semifinals, sorry for messing these names up, we'll see Tiffany Van Soos versus Jessica Gladstone. The winner of those two fights will move on to face each other way later that night as part of the Glory Collision Course to become the first Glory female, I believe they're calling this strawweight, junior strawweight champion of the world. Now, also on the Glory UFC Fight Pass Super Fight Series, you can see Daniel Alunga and Michael Dunt. That is going to be an excellent matchup. You move on to the Glory 36 card with Senchai and Gregorian fighting for a title fight at lightweight. So much kickboxing that it's going to be an excellent night of fights, all capped off leading up to Collision Course with Rico Vernhoeven, Badahari, vicious knockout artist, coming back out of retirement to take on the young reigning champion who has been dominating the sport, bringing up echoes of, is he the best of all time? Well, Badahari would like to check and see if the hype is really real. You would look for the more athletic, more mobile, I believe, younger fighter to be able to capitalize in the distance, but you can never count out the thunderous power that Badahari brings in. Nicky Holtzkin is defending his title against Cedric Doumbé. Gotta like the defense and the boxing skills of Holtzkin every time out. Ismael Lunt, crazy knees, taking on the big power of Jamal Ben Sadiq. And also, like we said, those two women fighting later, that is what you build up to on the Glory Collision Course. And that all leads, finally, to Saturday night, where, again, the UFC will shine. UFC 206, they are up in Ontario, Toronto, Canada, and the card gets kicked off on the UFC Fight Pass prelims with Zach Mikofsky, former Bellator Bantamweight champion, taking on Dustin Ortiz. A pivotal flyweight bout, as again, we're looking at somebody to make a run at being a real challenger for Mighty Mouse. You got number 10 versus number 7 right there. Two guys are very good with the scrambles. Ortiz, his striking is better than you would expect. A very tight, very technical fight. But again, Mikofsky, ranked number 7, comes in as the slight betting favorite. The scrambles will tell a lot about themselves. Also on the Fight Pass prelims, Rustam Khabibov versus Canadian Jason Sajo. Sajo, can he get his striking off as Khabibov will be looking to wrestle? In a striking delight, in a fight that I am ultra excited for, you're going to see Landon Vannata versus John McDessie. in another great lightweight fight. You have Drew Dober. Kickboxing is off the chain. His kickboxing in Muay Thai, insane. Also underrated grappling ability, taking on Olivier Aubameyang, who is trying to make his striking catch up to the level where his grappling is at, a very young, excited French-Canadian prospect. Taking the main event spot of the FS1 prelims, you have Nikita Krylov, Misha Krokanov, a fight, again, very important as we need contenders and new prospects in the light heavyweight division. Krylov, a Kyokushin karate black belt who also has some very good Brazilian jiu-jitsu, has been hurting guys on the feet, is able to submit them if need be, taking on Misha Krokanov, who has been all forward aggression, power, and sometimes a bit of wrestling in his so far 3-0 undefeated run in this division. A prospect and a possible contender will arise out of this one. Krylov is right now ranked at number 8 in the division. Krokanov at 13. The win streaks would mean something towards a really big matchup in the future for one of these young men. Now we move up to the main card where you're going to see Jordan Meehan, the return of Jordan Meehan after an early retirement. Even though he has 39 fights under his belt, still a very young man, very excited to return to see him returning to the octagon. Tim Kennedy meets Kelvin Gastelum. Both men were unable to fight for separate reasons at UFC 205. Kennedy, because Rashad Evans was not given a medical license. We thought we wouldn't see him at UFC 206 because, again, Kennedy could not get the Rashad Evans could not get the medical approval to get a license from the commission. We don't know what's fully going on with that, but Rashad Evans has said he will fight again. Tim Kennedy, obviously, as we just said, will be fighting. Kelvin Gastelum. Gastelum could not make weight at UFC 205 for welterweight. So, boom. He has now been forced by the promotion rightfully up to middleweight. He had such a hard time all along making welterweight. They should have never allowed him to do it. Kelvin Gastelum, will he be able to out-wrestle and out-grind Tim Kennedy? A very fun fight. The striking could tell a lot as they are both excellent wrestlers. Talking about young prospects wanting to announce their presence in the division and say that they're the guy that's going to take the future by the reins and lead it. Well, South Korea's top title hope, Do Ho Cho, the Korean Superboy, is going to be taking on number 4 ranked featherweight Cub Swanson. Swanson with 30 fights under his belt, double the experience, but has seen possibly his best run already passed by him. A 6-fight win streak that, if it was not for Frankie Edgar and a whole bunch of congestion in the featherweight division, could have seen Swanson challenging for a title and possibly rematching Jose Aldo. That did not go his way. We saw Cub Swanson fall down to sputter. And as the warrior he is, he came back from adversity, has found his way back into the win column, and now has a young, hungry, very entertaining, explosive striking knockout artist in a unassuming body coming his way. A very entertaining fight. The co-main event, as we go up to that, is a welterweight bout with Donald Cowboy Cerrone, who may or may not already have a black eye closed from who knows what sparring with possibly Joe Schilling, taking on Matt Brown. Matt Brown got stopped quick at UFC 202, hurt bad. I'm surprised to honestly be seeing him back in action this quick after hearing about certain concussion problems that he had. Donald Cerrone has looked amazing since moving up to 170 pounds. They have found the right sequence, the right preparation on fight day to get him into his optimum mode to be able to go into the octagon and perform quickly, to not be that slow starter, to not get stuck in neutral and get beat to the punch before the fight even begins. I look for Cerrone to be able to continue his impressive winning ways, but it is hard to count out Matt Brown. The man has had his back against the wall so many times, is a very good boxer, was showing some very interesting things before getting caught by Jake Ellenberger. Hands down, great movement. This one, again, could have fireworks written all over it, and that's leading it up to the main event. the UFC featherweight interim title fight. Yes, I know, I can't even believe I'm saying it, but Anthony Showtime Pettis blessed Max Holloway. Not that Max Holloway does not deserve to be in a title fight. Not that Max Holloway does not deserve to be in a main event, but when this fight was already announced some time ago, and it wasn't a title fight, to make it a title fight 3 weeks out just because the main event title fight got canceled, to have that really affect and cause Conor McGregor to be stripped, to give Aldo the real title, to make this an interim title fight, that is all blasphemy and nonsensicalness. But that does not deter from the fact that this is going to be a really fun fight. I mean, Anthony Pettis, the second time making 145 pounds. You know what you do after that first time. You can handle the cut a little better. Does he have better cardio? We saw his grappling. It's up a level working with Israel Martinez, with Izzy-style wrestling. It went up a level. Submitting a guy like Charles Oliveira, it tells you where his Brazilian jiu-jitsu is at. But has he got the faith back in his striking to put combinations together to not rely on one big shot? Because Max Holloway is a tight grappler, very technical striker, who does not leave many holes to be open. I mean, he took advantage and beat Cub Swanson, who again is an open, flowing, looking for a big shot kind of guy like Pettis, even though Pettis is a much more kicking-oriented striker. I like Holloway in this one because he stays tighter in his defense, because he likes to use his long punches, and because he will stick to his game plan and his striking, his P's and his Q's better. Again, with Pettis, I feel that it's big moves, all or nothing. I look for Holloway to take the title, to be the interim champion, and to line up early 2017 facing Jose Aldo. So it's an action-packed weekend. I mean, like I said, there's the final RFA event. There's a UFC fight night. There is glory, the three phases of glory, as I'm going to call it. You do still have Bellator and a UFC 206. It is a huge weekend. It's been a huge show, and we're not done yet. Next up, we got Kevin Ross joining us.
ISP, that's International Strategic Partners. When you think protection in New Mexico, you should think ISP, not your everyday security company, offering background checks, self-defense courses, handgun, firearm, licensing, and a plethora of security patrol and investigation options. Call us at 505-255-6063. That's 505-255-6063. 6063 or online at callisp.com.
The Fight Shop New Mexico in the Montaño Plaza Shopping Center, located off Coors and Montaño.
Welcome back to the DC Life Uncensored, and right now we're gonna welcome in one of the top strikers in all of North America, the Soul Assassin, Kevin Ross. Thank you for the time, sir. How you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm well. Really excited for the opportunity to get to speak to you. Wanted to know, first off, you've been in this game for so long, and how young were you, and at what age did you fall in love with martial arts, first off?
I kind of always loved martial arts growing up and fighting. You know, I used to watch a lot of boxing and obviously loved martial arts movies, but it wasn't until 1994 was the first time I ever saw Muay Thai, and I knew right then if I was ever gonna fight, which I thought about before, but never too seriously. But I knew that's what I wanted to do if I was ever gonna do it. But it wasn't until 2003 that I actually finally got in the gym and got started.
So what was that first time? How did you end up seeing it for the first time, Muay Thai?
It was actually on ESPN. They used to show fights really late at night, Muay Thai fights, and all the old school ones just randomly. They still do from time to time, but it just happened to be on TV. You know, as I said, when I was younger, I thought about maybe fighting, maybe boxing, or doing something like that. But I love martial arts a lot, but I never saw any kind of martial arts or any real fighting, you know, and it wasn't until that day I was hooked immediately. I was like, if I ever do fight or do train, that is what I want to do. This is it.
A decade after that, then, why did you finally walk into a gym?
alcoholic by the time I was 15, so I knew if I was going to go after this, I'd have to give all that up, you know, and I wasn't ready to do that. You know, I didn't even know how serious I was about it. I didn't think anyone else would take me seriously either. And I kind of just put it in the back of my mind. And then, you know, over the years it would pop up and I'd just ignore it and not think twice about it. And, you know, after a long series of bad things happening, one being that one of my best friends passed away while he was waiting for a heart transplant, that was in 98. You know, when that happened, I made a promise to myself that I would go after this, but unfortunately that sent me even into more of a downward spiral into alcoholism, and it wasn't until, you know, a series of really other bad things happened, but all in like a month's period of time with a friend dying and almost going to jail, and, you know, I finally snapped out of it and realized I was wasting my life, and I was in the gym the next day, and that was history.
And now, since then, this has kind of been the addiction?
Yeah, without a doubt. I definitely have an addictive personality, but that can be a positive thing if you point it in the right direction.
And through that direction, and through this, I believe, 54-fight career, I've read, you're considered in the Muay Thai world one of the faces, at least, of American Muay Thai. So, when you hear something like that, does it like really sink into you for such a legendary sport overseas, what you've been able to do for it here in America?
You know, I don't know if it'll ever sink in. I mean, even to this day, I get really weird when people want to take photos of me. It's very strange and foreign to me, you know, even though it's been going on forever now. I've never really viewed myself as someone different than anybody else, even if it's their first day walking in the gym. I'm just someone that's here trying to be the best that I can be, trying to get better every day. So I don't look at myself as this person that's like out there in the spotlight and I've done all these things. And, you know, I'm just on this road along with everyone else that's trying to do it. I'm very grateful of the things I've been able to accomplish and the fact that people do view me as that person. You know, and I'm very, very fortunate to have been able to help the sport grow, and that's always been my goal, is to help the sport grow, help myself, and help anyone else along the way that I can.
So from the love that you have from the sport, and for the first time you watched it, like a lot of us, you probably had the thought of, why is this not bigger out here?
You know, it was never really something I was like, why isn't this, you know, bigger? I felt it was unfortunate that there wasn't a lot of people, you know, when I first started, and not a single person around knew what it was other than people training in it. You know, this was before, like, the YouTube and everything else was out there that people could easily go and view it. You know, when you told people you didn't Muay Thai, they had no idea what you were talking about, so then you had to say it's like kickboxing. People know what that is, but they just figure that's like the pants fighting. And then you had to say it's not like that, and then, you know, most times you wouldn't say anything, you wouldn't correct them and just walk off. So I've seen kind of why it hasn't grown. I mean, I don't know why it's taken so long, other than, you know, just the right pieces of the puzzle haven't fallen into place. You know, I mean, you look at MMA and how long did they struggle for before it finally blew up, and, you know, you look at that sport and like, why isn't everybody wants it, but it's not out there, you know, it's not out there like boxing is, and it just took the right people and the right combination and the right series of events to come along to help it get there. And, you know, I always knew that I'd be someone that would help it get to that point. I always knew it would get to that point eventually. I just never really ever dreamed that I'd still be fighting when it did, you know, and the fact that I'm still here doing this and doing it at such a high level, it just blows me away, and I'm very grateful.
Big fixture in the Muay Thai world, but we're here talking about Bellator kickboxing coming up in Italy, your second time going out there to perform with Bellator in this arena. Are you as happy competing in kickboxing as you are in Muay Thai, or is there still more love towards one, but competing wise, are you happy whether it's either one?
Yeah, I'm happy without a doubt. You know, Muay Thai will always be my first love and my passion. But kickboxing is definitely the next best thing, and I'm very grateful, especially at this stage of my career, to be venturing to something different. You know, it kind of re-sparked a lot of things, and kind of found a new love and passion for to help develop in other areas of my game. So I think I love it. I'm so happy to be here and doing this.
Do you ever have those, I guess, just mental moments where you want to throw an elbow or you want to go into the clinch? Or are you still trying to work through some of those Muay Thai instincts with the kickboxing rules?
Well, you know, I've had a lot of different fights over my career, you know, from, you know, not being able to get fights and just having to take whatever I could get, from boxing to Sanchiao to kickboxing to MMA. And, you know, it's one of those things where, in my mind, like, I can see the opportunities, and it's really frustrating not to be able to do that. But there's never been a point where I was actually worried about it. But yeah, I definitely see the things I can do, and I just have to ignore my instincts to do them, which is unfortunate.
With the long career you've had in taking random fights, has there been a time where, not has it been a problem, but where it was awkward, like mentally thinking about what you could or couldn't throw, like just like the change in the rules on a short notice?
Yeah, without a doubt. You know, even just my first fight with Bellator, I was sitting in there in the fight thinking, what can I do, what can I not do? And instead of just being able to flow and go and fight, you know, you end up thinking, which is not a good thing to be doing when you're fighting, because things are happening at such a fast pace. If you're thinking about what you can't do and what you can, that's going to slow you down. You know, fortunately, I've had experience doing that, but yeah, on those short notice fights, like, I've had 4 boxing fights, and every one of them was on a week's notice, so I'd never been even any real boxing training. So it was, you know, I've had just about every experience in fighting that you can possibly have, so it's nothing new. So now, actually, knowing that I'm in this sport, this is what I train for, this is what my mind is wrapped around while I'm in the gym, you know, it's a lot easier. And I'm, you know, that last fight was much better than the first fight, and I think this fight I'm finally going to have all those cobwebs out of the way, the things that would slow me down, and be able to just do what I do.
So do you steer away from working your elbows and working your clinch work for a fight like this when you've had significant notice and you know it's full kickboxing rules?
Yeah, without a doubt. I mean, I always train those things just to have them, you know, as a martial artist in general. I mean, even if I wasn't fighting, I would still want to keep those things sharp, but I do steer away from them, you know, the months or the last few weeks leading up to a fight. You know, I definitely still clinch, not as much because it's so minimal, but there's, you know, from time to time, you get in that clinch situation and you need to be able to fire things off correctly, even if it's only for a second. So, you know, I make the adjustments that I need to.
You've had so much experience, like you said, all these different types of fights. I got to wonder, is there one fight that sticks out in your mind where there was an injury or a cut that was the most bothersome? Something like that, that hampered your performance in a fight that really sticks out to you?
You mean something that happened that hindered me in the fight?
Yeah.
Oh, geez. There's so many, you know? I'd say one of the biggest ones was when I fought with the flu. I actually had pneumonia, and I didn't know it at the time. I was just like, it was one of those things where I was sick, but I was kind of putting it in the back of my mind, like ignoring it, and, you know, just pushed through anyway. And after the first round, like, my entire body just shut down, and, you know, I felt like I was underneath water, like drowning in sand or something. But I was actually able to, you know, pull it out, and still was able to come out with the win, but that definitely hindered me more than anything. I mean, I've broken my hand in fights and been injured and cut and all those things, but I don't think there's ever been something that shut me completely down as much as that did.
talk about adding like another level of epicness to your already legendary status. I'm thinking last time I had a flu, I was in bed and probably a whiny bitch, but just to go have a Muay Thai fight and come out victorious, I'm like, wow, that's some pretty epic stuff right there, sir.
Yeah, that's right, man. You know, you never really know until you're in the situation where you have a choice to make. You either do it or you quit, and I'm never going to quit. So, you know, when you get through fights like that, it really just makes you stronger. You know, even if I was to come off of that with a loss, just knowing that I can push through that, like, how do you think you're going to feel now when you're healthy? It's pretty opens your mind up a lot.
And then with all this endowed passion about martial arts, what are some things that you do to relax, to step away from that world?
Just hang out, sleep. You know, I like to go to the beach. You know, I really just try to not think about fighting whatsoever. You know, when I really need to unwind and get away from it. But I don't really like to do things. You know, just spend time relaxing and enjoying life and not worrying about training, not worrying about fighting, not worrying about weight and all these things, and just relax with my loved ones and my family that I have to spend so much time away from.
Just some good solid downtime, basically.
Yeah, without a doubt.
And now, heading, how have you liked the traveling that your martial arts career has allowed you to take part in?
Oh man, it's one of the best parts about fighting. You know, it definitely does have its good and its bad points, because you are getting to travel and see all these places, but you're also working. You know what I mean? You're over there fighting most of the time. That you're spending there is in preparation for your fight. So it's not like you're being a tourist and hanging out and relaxing, having some drinks or whatever. You know, you're cutting weight or training and then getting ready to fight. And usually you leave right away. But you know, last time we were out there, we spent a few days extra, and this time I'm gonna do that as well. So it's been amazing getting to travel, even when I don't really get to enjoy the places like most people would. Just being there, being around all kinds of different people, and just seeing the world has been one of the best parts about this journey.
Now, while you're out there, you're going to be facing Alessio, and I'm not going to say his last name because I'm sure I'm going to mess it up. But what do you feel going into this fight? Now your third time with the Bellator kickboxing. What do you feel is going to be your biggest advantage in this fight?
My experience will always be a huge advantage, but I'd say one of the biggest advantages I've always had is my heart and my willingness to push past any kind of you know, thing standing in my way, whether that be an injury or sickness or cuts or anything like that. You know, there's nothing that's ever going to break me. You couldn't break me no matter what. I'm going to go out to the death if I have to. You know, this is what I love to do, and I would never give up. And, you know, most people, even if they say they have that, they don't. You know, when it really comes down to it, you know, you people, and that's kind of actually how I got my nickname, was just, you know, pushing past that and breaking people's willing spirit. And that's always been something I go in there to do. You know, I don't really go in there to knock people out. I'd rather make people quit. You know, it's anyone can get knocked out, but to quit is something you have to consciously do. And you know, I would much rather make someone not want to do this anymore than just to catch them with a clean shot.
Most of the fight game is mental. What are your thoughts on the mental side of the kickboxing Muay Thai game?
You know, so a lot of people like to say it's 60%, 50%. I always like to say it's 100%, because if you don't have it mentally, you're not going to be able to do it physically, you know? And then, you know, seeing that going into fights where I didn't get to train, you know, I took it on a couple hours notice, and if you have the will and the desire to win, you will find a way to do it, you know? And your mind can overcome a lot of areas where you might be lacking in skill or preparation, and that's something I was, you know, fortunate enough to learn throughout my entire career, and just something that's been pounder than you, even much more so as the years have gone on.
Now, with the years having gone on and you have all this experience behind you, is it easy for you to still find new goals of new things you want to accomplish?
Yeah, because, you know, my goals never really have an end. You know, I want to be the best person, the best fighter that I can be. You know, there's things that pop up, like titles and belts and rankings and things like that, that, you know, kind of give you a something to look at and say, I made it to this point or I made it to that point. But, you know, my main goal has always been to be the best that I can be, and there's no end to that. So in that sense, it's not that hard to find the motivation. You know, making this venture into kickboxing has sparked a lot of my desire to get better in different areas. And, you know, with a new organization, obviously I want to get that belt around my waist. So that's another, you know, thing that drives me. You know, my goals will always be the same, to be the best.
Has working with Bellator, is this a different kind of experience than other promotions?
Oh my gosh, it's like it's like night and day. I mean, Bellator, without a doubt, is the best promotion I've ever fought for. You know, it's like night and day, and it's wonderful. Yet at the same time, you know, you think, what, 13 years of this, I've been, you know, basically like clawing my way through everything I get to just get a few pennies, and then, you know, to have an organization that is such a well-known organization, but also a promotion that really looks out and takes care of the fighters. You know, Scott Coker is without a doubt the best promoter there is in the fight game, and he's a true fan of the sport and then someone that does it right. You know, he knows that the athletes are his product, and he knows that he needs to take care of them and treat them right. You know, most of the time when you're fighting for people, you just feel like an employee as opposed to someone that's part of this thing. And we're helping each other. We're trying to help grow the sport. We're trying to grow our product, which is us, which is the promotion. And Sky is one of the only people I've ever seen that actually gets that.
Hopefully, look forward to seeing bigger platforms and bigger audiences for Muay Thai, for kickboxing, for, you know, what you were part of starting with Lion Fights, and also how it's transitioned over to Bellator. Now, one thing we've seen throughout your career is people talk of exciting fights and you being an exciting fighter. Have you been able to characterize yourself like that, or you just think of it as I go out there to, as you said, break your opponent, and it's just what, you know, transpires in your efforts of trying to win the fight?
Yeah, I mean, that's just who I am as a person, who I am as a fighter. You know, it's something, you know, you can, well, that's one thing I love about fighting. You can talk all you want, you can say all these things, but who you really are will come out once you're in that ring, regardless of the situation. And, you know, I don't want to say it's something that I intentionally go out there to do, like, I'm going to put on an amazing show, but I mean, it's something that's in the back of my mind. You know, I always want to go out there and do my best, but even if it's at my own detriment, which has happened in the past, where I could have fought a little bit smarter and won a fight, but it was more important for me to put on an exciting show, and, you know, came out losing. But I'd always rather put on an exciting fight and lose than a boring fight and win. So that's something I think people know that they can get from me, and I have always known, is, you know, when I'm in there, it's going to be exciting no matter what. And, you know, that's what the fans expect out of me, and I'd expect that out of myself.
Kevin, I got to thank you so much for this opportunity. Last thing, was there anybody you needed a shout out to or thank?
Yeah, just all my sponsors, Triumph United, Monster Energy, On It, all those guys that take care of me, all my friends, family, fans, and everybody else. I appreciate you all.
One more time, that was Kevin Ross. Thank you to him, Landon Vannata, and LaMarcus Tucker. There's a big weekend ahead for all of us combat sports fans, with the UFC having two events, RFA's final event, Bellator in Italy, and the big Glory Collision Course event, the three parts of it, in Germany. This has been the DC Life Uncensored. Thank you to the Fight Shop New Mexico. Visit them at the northeast corner of the Corso Montano Shopping Center, the far north end of that shopping center. Also, thank you to International Strategic Partners. Reach them at callisp.com. And also to Damage Control Mouth Guards, the top mouth guard brand in the industry. This has been the DC Life Uncensored, presented on cagedminds.com. Thank you for joining us. Me, the whole show.